So we are live now on Ambedkar Caravan Media, and today we are going to have a very entirely different journey in the world of literature, in the world of arts, and in the world of the burgeoning Ambedkarite literary movement throughout the length and breadth of our country, where people like Yogesh are contributing so much to this side of our movement, which is very, very interesting development in the movement. You know, the literature has always been the part of our movement. People have been writing and producing literature. They are writing novels, they are writing poetries, they are writing all different forms of all different literary forms. And literature or literary movement has been a very important and integral part of the movement of emancipation of our people, and not only in India but all over the places where people find the creative expressions to break the old patterns, the old way of looking at the things, the old way of doing the things, the old way of writings, and come up with very creative and very human sort of literary forms which has potential to transform our consciousness. And whoever engages with those kind of literary forms, they can change dramatically, drastically through this kind of an interaction with the literature. Today we have with us Yogesh Maitreya. Yogesh, Jai Bhim.
Jai Bhim, sir.
Yogesh has been somebody who is, from his young age, he is devoted to to literature. Particular language that he has been fascinated since his, I would say, childhood, because I know him for a long time when he was growing up as a young boy. He has this fascination for the English literature, and he read widely of all whatever he laid his hands on. And he was maybe he was 19 then. He has come up then with a novel. And, you know, when he was very young, he wrote a novel with that included different you know, themes, different symbols, and I hope that someday that novel will see the publication. I don't know, you know, a lot of time has gone now, but since then he has been spreading his interest in the vernacular language literature, which is written widely by our people, not only in Marathi but also in other languages like Telugu, Kannada, Tamil, and all those languages which our people speak in different parts of our country. And one of the astonishing thing that Yogesh has done is he started a publication house called Panther's Paw Publication House, and it has been public so far. I think it has published six books, Yogesh.
Yeah, six
books are published by Panther's Paw, and they are very amazing sort of books, including one of his very important novel, short stories, the collection of short stories, Flowers on the Grave of Caste, which is sort of a very different genre where the characters have peculiar names, and you know, their social histories are interwoven with the social histories of other. So it's an amazing work of short stories that Yogesh has produced. But one of the fascinating nature of Yogesh is to create a platform or opening for young writers who can find their works published so that larger number of people can consume the work. And that has been a great, I would say, a contribution of Yogesh. Another thing that Yogesh has been doing recently, he has been organizing the writers from all over the places. And he recently had a wonderful workshop bringing in writers, and you know, they read together, they spoke in different languages, and they sort of come up with a kind of a blueprint for how we can create Ambedkar as a culture, Ambedkar as a literary figure, literature as a way of producing a new consciousness, and so on and so forth. So very amazing work that Yogesh has been doing. And I think with this brief introduction and the background, I will stop here, and I will request Yogesh to begin with his presentation or talk today, and we will follow it up with the question and answers. Yogesh, warm welcome, and the dais is yours now, Yogesh.
Thank you, sir. Jai Bhim, those who are attending this, thank you for joining in. My name is Yogesh Maitreya, and As we have known that we are going to like, I mean, I'm going to share my experiences. I'm not, you know, like a erudite scholar or something, but I am like, I can share my experience in literary field in terms of Dalit movement, Ambedkarite movement, like, you know, the, in terms of the the larger movement against caste. So basically, like when you talk about Ambedkar, like literature and you know, like connecting, connecting with the world. So one must you know, like acknowledge that today, like some people or some Savarnas claim that they are, you know, by publishing or writing about Ambedkar, they are claiming to make Ambedkar global, but they did not understand, and they completely cover up the fact that Ambedkar was always a global person. You know, he went to Colombia, then his books were published from London, his papers were discussed there, he had an acquaintance with the scholars and intellectuals there. So he was always, you know, he had a presence there in the Western world long before anybody could claim. So the now cutting short to the literary field, so we know that Babasaheb like, you know, led movement in social domain, you know, political domain, and he was too much engaged with the political field or the political domain, and like, you know, like doing all sorts of struggle. But somewhere, like a reader in him, somewhere a writer in him, because when he was growing up as a boy, like very few people know that he has adapted Shakespeare's play called Kingslayer into a Marathi version, and he has, like, you know, like adapted that. He has, you know, staged that in where he was living in Dubuk Chowk in Lower Parel. So he had a deep interest in literature as well as you know, like a very keen understanding of how literature can be connected with the life, and also vision that literature should come out of life. So somewhere around 1940s, when Shankar Rao Khara, one of the, you know, like lawyers from our early lawyers and the graduate from our community back then, was working with Babasaheb newspaper, Prabuddha Bharat, and and he was an editor. So Babasaheb told him that, like, so far, like, many people from our community are going to be a doctor, going to be a lawyer, going to be engineer. They are going to make their mark in all sorts of fields, but the stories of our communities are equally important. So he suggested Mr. Shankar Rao Khara, that the story of our community should be reached, you know, across the countries, across the continents, and across the communities. So he had given him a vision. Babasaheb himself was a, you know, like erudite scholar, as in a writer. He was a philosopher, and we know that he intended to write his biography. He intended to write his autobiography. He intended to write biography of Phule, but except waiting for visa, there is no personal account which he had written. So that is the fact. But he had a vision. So, and that vision was very, very much necessary for what we today known as Dalit literature, because the background, the blueprint of that literature we call Dalit literature, Ambedkarite literature, anti-caste literature, the blueprint of it is Babasaheb's vision. So when he said that stories of our people should reach to the people, so what kind of stories? Like, and who are our people? Let us say, like, we can assume that he meant untouchables. So there were so many untouchable castes in Maharashtra, in every state. So when he says that our people, he specifically meant, although it was very much implicit, but he specifically meant that stories of untouchable people, because the background experience of untouchability is so exclusive that it is very difficult for people to understand unless it is written. That experience is so complex, it is sometimes magical for people, because it does not appear true to them. So that is why he said stories, because stories can make complex thing look much easier and clear. So that is why he meant the stories. Now Shankara started with writing short stories. He had written autobiography. He had written short story collection and many other essays. So he was one of the founding father of Dalit literature. Now, one of the first person, like, and after that, Bandhu Madhav, who used to write with the pseudonym, like he was a police sub-inspector back then in 1940s, 45s. Now, like 40s, 50s, 60s, these three decades, like after, within these three decades, so many, life-changing things have taken place, like, you know, like Britishers have gone, like Indians have taken over the rules, Savarna Indians have taken over the rules. And then Baba Sahib conversion happened. The most remarkable thing which had changed the, you know, like which has changed all the dimensions of the earlier Mahar and other Dalit communities in Maharashtra and also across India. Now, their struggle, even after conversion, their struggle did not stop, because although they became Buddhists, they know that they are Buddhists, they are now going to live their life as a Buddhist and like a Buddhist, they are trying very hard. But in the eyes of people, they were, you know, still Mahas, still Dalits. So now, it was very within these three decades, like 40s, 50s, and 60s, a class within us has emerged. Like RPI leadership has initially shown a lot of potential. They have produced MPs and MLAs, and now because of Congress, there was a fraction. There were several fractions in RPI. Now these leaders were totally. It seems it is a critique of Dalit Panther that these leaders were, totally aloof from the people, or they did not, remain true to the concerns of people. Because of that, there were lots of atrocities, and the peak of it was the decade of 70s. Now, it is a critique of Dalit Panther. Now, from this, there was a class of people among us, like who grew, who is like, in a way deracinated or uprooted from the history of the struggle of our people, who has achieved because of their struggle, of course, they have achieved good position, they have achieved financial stability and become class onto themselves. But there were millions of other people among our own community that who are living the life which is still unimaginable for so many people. Now from this lumpen, so I call it like Dalit Panthers or lumpen proletariats. Now they were there. When they have taken or, intended to fight also with their literature, this anxiety was very much, manifested. It was very much seen into their literature. Now, their literature was like, it has not only broken the frameworks of the earlier literature, which was written in Marathi, but also it casted a light on subjects and the people who were not known or who were put into the darkness into the field of literature. So now we become protagonists in the literature also. Now the fertile period of literature was until 1990s, like people were writing creatively. Namdev Dasar is a vantage point. There were so many people. Daya Power is a vantage point. Baburao Bagul is a vantage point. Urmila Power is a vantage point. Arun Kale is a vantage point in Marathi when it comes to Dalit literature. But after 1990s, when LPG, like liberalization, privatization, and globalization happened, like that's what we say. So when it happened, it has opened up the economy, and that openness of economy had like, you know, clearly affected our lives in a way, in a sense that what it was going to decide our engagement with the literature. Now, we see that, like when we say that, we talk about Baba Saheb, when we talk about carrying his vision across the world, wherever we are and however, in whatever way, whichever way we can, we must understand that it is not only possible by, you know, like organized religion, but it is very much also possible by the creation of the literature. Because you know, how we connect as a human society, in a human society, we connect with each other by languages. We do not connect because, like, I won't connect with the Japanese or the Chinese or the Vietnamese or the Buddhist from that society, because I, although our religions are same, although like somewhere the precept, there is a centrality, our centrality of our lives, our cultural centrality is same, yet there is a language which I can understand. There is a food culture. There is an entire way of life which is not mine. So how are we going to, you know, make Baba Saheb global in a way we are thinking to? So it is only much possible that when we are going to share our stories with them. So when we say we are going to share our stories with them in a complex country called India, which means that we write our stories in our own languages. Like when we say my people from Kerala writing their stories, so they are, if they're writing in Malayalam, I don't understand. So how I am going to connect with my people in Malayalam, in Kerala, or with Tamil? Just because they are my people are from the same caste, it won't make sense that I'm going to connect with them unless I communicate with them. So how I'm going to communicate with them is, the language is a tool, the language is a bridge. So when we see that making Ambedkar global, we need to emphasize very much on translations. Now, lot of confusions, lot of setbacks which anti-caste movement had witnessed in last 20 years is because of the lack of translation. It is lack of translation in interstate manner and in international manner. Now, I don't find anybody who is putting stress on, you know, making or like trying to produce Baba Saheb's writing in Deutsch, in French, in Russian, in Chinese, in Japanese, in all other languages. Now, these are the international languages. I am not also seeing such somebody is very much dedicated to making stories available from one language to another, like again, the translation. So like if I have to talk about translation, it will take entire, like, and it's altogether different subject, but it is equally important when you talk about Ambedkar literature and connecting with the world. Because the kind of life we live, we write it, like we try to imagine it in a literary way and then we put it. But how I am going to connect with my story, with the world, is only because that when my stories are read by these people, are heard by these people in the language they understand. So we need specifically a movement of people who are dedicated to language question. When it comes to the language, it also comes to the language politics and the translation politics. So I like, because there are so many things, so many aspects of the movement, and so many aspects by which Baba Saheb can be made global. But I think language and the translation is one of the two main aspects which can radically change the scenario, which can radically strengthen the movement we envision to build. So I think, I just want to put my like own example from my own life, like how it is, how how I had like I had seen this that working like when I have like Mr. I have translated Mr. Jami Pawar's first volume about Ambedkarite movement after Ambedkar. Mr. Jami Pawar is a one of the founding member of Dalit Panther, and he had written five volumes on Ambedkarite movement after Ambedkar, apart from like 40 or 45 other books. Now I have translated first volume in English, and then like, you know, this is like organic history. It is not written in a way that any loose, you know, like mainstream or the so-called mainstream writers write, but it is like organic history. It is like a, it is like a, it is the voice of an activist, but it is equally important. Why it is equally important? Because one of the thing, because like one of the thing I have understood about the problems of the movement is not the ideological, the, you know, if the movement has a, the movement, the, you know, the setback which movement witnesses, it not because of the ideological differences, it's not because of their philosophical differences, it is because of, it is because of the personal. It is very much personal. It is between the representative and their personal or their personalities. So this organic history I have never read anywhere. So that gave me the clarity, and that also gave me one insight that unless you read the organic history, you cannot connect with the world. And that is very much impossible. Today we read black writers, we know black poets, we know black writers, at least for four or five black writers we know. But how many black people know there are, how many black people know how many Dalit writers? It is our failure actually, because we did not reach to them. It is how many French people know the Dalit writers, except of course Baba Saheb, like, and the famous this one, autobiographies. I mean, the autobiographies is the like most repeated genre we have. We need more creative sort of narratives which can blow up the mind of people, because the reality is so complex. So the, for the complex reality, you need the complex form of narratives. So that now, why it didn't happen? Because earlier people have a very limited means of producing things. You know, I know how publications work. Earlier people did not have this many means of production or the producing literature. They have limited, but they produce more. Today we have more, but we are producing less and less. It means that we are not actually connecting with the organic history. Actually, I'm not saying the history which we think as a history, but because I also feel the limitation of, like, you know, talking from a university position or like belonging to the university so far, like as a representative, that we assume that this is a world in itself and we represent our people. No, I don't think so, that we are the representative of people. The representative of our people are always on the ground. So they know the world better than us. What we know is of, you know, fed to us by the bourgeois, Savarna, Brahmin academy. So most of us fall trapped into that, you know, narrative games. So it is, so for me, like, unless and until it is, we identify, we nourish, we produce more and more writer from our community across the languages, and focus on translation, make language and translation as a movement. I don't think so that we can really make Baba Saheb global in a sense, because there will be the statues and the bust of Baba Saheb will be placed in the universities. You know, people will research borrowing literature from Baba Saheb, from his idea. They will do, you know, like a lot of intellectualism on that, but it is for their benefit. None major, the movement succeeds when majority of the community achieves that goal, when majority of the community feels that liberation. So I don't think that so it will only happen that when Instead of Baba Sahib bus putting in Colombia, there should be 1,000 scholars from our community in Colombia. That is the real tribute to him. Then Baba Sahib won't be in just visualizing bus, but he will be there very much every day, written, spoken, and understood in a way, and the way we are going to speak and deal and the struggle against the hegemony there. So this is what I had to say. I wanted to keep it brief. It's been 25 minutes. So if anyone of you have any questions, so we can talk, and we can share question and answers.
Yogesh, as a writer yourself, and I would say the way you are trying to understand the history of the literary movement, particularly in Maharashtra, and you have written a book, actually translated a book written by J.V. Pawar. Can you tell us about the relationship between the literary movement and the rise of Dalit Panthers?
That's a phenomenon, a kind of phenomena. So as I said that 1940s, 50s and 60s. Now I mentioned that three major things happened, foreign rulers were gone and the native rulers came 1947. Then a new class among us, most of the people second class, first class officers and job, they have acquired with their struggle, of course, and a lot of hard work, so which is very much commendable. Now, when faction took place in RPI because of Congress, with the intervention of Congress, now this initially split into two, and then it has got four and several other factions. Now, because of these fractions, the representative of our people, the people or the individuals to whom our people looked up there, for their own struggle, or they thought that these people are our leaders, they are going to lead our life, B.C. Kamble or Dada Sahib Gaikwad or Bhandare. So there are so many, four or five main people from the first faction whom people looked up. Now, because they, after split into RPI, they got too much into this split politics. So they kept themselves busy. So except Bhumihin and the Satyagraha during 60s, which led by Dada Sahib Gaikwad, there is no substantial movement we see. And now when 1970s, by 1970s, atrocities on Dalit people, especially Mahars, have gone rampant. Now, the people who have founded Dalit Panthers, like J.V. Pawar, Raja Dale, Namdev Dasar, Arun Kamble, now these were the, Raja Dale was a graduate, Namdev was a totally lumpen proletariat type person. Jaggi was a banker, sophisticated. But all of them were first generation learner. The first one from their family, their entire history to feel that liberation. Now, listening or reading the new story of atrocities every day, brutal kind of atrocities. So they feel, obviously they feel anxious. Now, they were also reader. They were actually artists, creative artists. Very few people know that Namdev also used to draw paintings. He was a painter. He was a good painter. Very few people know that Raja Dale was a good illustrator, very fine illustrators.
Wow, this is a new information, Raja Dale.
He was a best calligrapher. His calligraphy is it's like a craft. So these people, actually what I mean to say is these people are creative people. Now, they were young, 20, 21, 22. What is that age? and that was 70s. Now you are reading, like, you know, these people didn't have any means of distraction, because 70s was something like after 56 conversion happened. It was just 14 years, right? After the demise of Baba Sahib, it's just 14 years, and they have seen the Baba Sahib movement, the effect of it, how strong it was. They have seen that, and they felt that these atrocities are, like, you know, going rampant. So we should do something. And of course, like any human person at their place would have thought the same. So Dalit Panther came up as a, you know, radical organic response to these atrocities. Now, since these people were artists, they also brought this rage, this anxiety, this anger, and this the element of resistance into their literature. So with all these things, it has also broken the boundaries of, you know, the way literature was going to read, write, and understood. Now, Dalit Panther from the ground has now totally, like, you know, almost defunct and not existed. But we must understand the power of literature. The literature they have written, it is still guiding people. The literature still has an impact. So that is why, I mean, when I emphasize too much on creation of the literature, not only literature, but also literature, and equally important. So these were, that is the background of Dalit Panthers, the rise of Dalit Panther, and also the rise of Dalit literature as a phenomena, or reaching to the phenomena. Now, not many people know, because it's just a theory. In one of my article, I made this theory that JNU was formed in 1969.
Right.
Now, Dalit Panther came into started in 71, and 72 was, it was like officially formed, that Dalit Panther, they were starting. Now, and Amitabh Bachchan's phenomena started also from 72, 71, 72, 73, 74, 5. Right. Now, the people, you know, this Salim, the script writers, now where from they get this idea of Dalit, angry young man? Who were this angry young man of 70s? You know, whom Amitabh Bachchan portrayed on his on screen. Now, it is an image of a Dalit Panthers, because at that time, not only Marathi, but English media too have taken, English media too had acknowledged the activities of Dalit Panther, and they have started writing on them. Now, Dalit Panthers were also corresponding through letters with Black Panthers during that same time. Now, seeing all these movements happening, Dalit Panthers clashes with Shiv Sena, their, you know, arguments with communists. Now, that period, that anger, that youth was Dalit Panther. That man was a real angry man on the ground. Now, these people just, you know, we know that Bollywood is very much cunning in terms of when it comes to deform or appropriating your history. So that anger, that angry young man was Dalit Panther, actually. I hope, like, this, we could have get a more honest picture if there was any Dalit director from us during that time who could have make a mainstream movie. So we could have really seen who is that angry young man on the screen also. So, because when JNU happened in 1969, and the researchers they did, like, in terms of, like, poverty, exploitation, social movement, on the communist, communist line, well, they were from the beginning, they were communist, they were following communist lines of liberation or emancipation. But it was actually like their correspondence with scholars correspondent with the Bombay filmmaker or the scriptwriters, from which they have get this idea. The only thing that we lack the resources from the beginning, that is why our stories are never been reach to the people in a way they should have. So that is why I emphasized on the story, like, you know, they brought our image, they brought our history, they presented, they put that history into upper caste character, and that character become angry man. Like, there is, like as Kufir said, that there is no need for any Khanna or Mehra or any, you know, any Khatri, Savarna, Brahmin, Kshatriya, who become angry in 70s. He had everything. For what? Like, as Kufir said, for what he was angry at? This was Dalit Panthers. Even not in a communist, like they were the, we know that they, how they, in a way, when it comes to being revolutionary, they are. So it was basically Dalit Panther who reflected into Amitabh Bachchan that anger belonged to the Dalit Panther. But the only thing, we lacked resources, so we cannot resurrect, we cannot claim that anger that is ours.
Now, going from the Panthers to the present, and with what kind of a motivation you started this Panthers Pop? Like, what is it in the name that, you know, you chose this name for your publication house, Panthers Pop? How do you relate it with the continuity of the Dalit Panthers movement, or is it, you know, is it out of context, or is there a context, historical context to the name that you have given to your publication house?
No, there is, like, there is some thought behind it. When I was thinking about the name, like, basically, like, Panthers point, like, the impression of panther, which panthers left, you know, they walked, they have created tremendous body of literature, like lots of people, hundreds of writers they have created, and they helped create it. Help giving birth to hundreds of writers. Now, this publication is a small, very minuscule step towards recognizing that movement, that literary movement, that literary influence which Dalit Panthers has created. So it's like a panther's paw, like it's an impression of a panther. So it is not we do not have the circumstances they had, so it can't be just panther, but it's a panther's paw, you know, it's an impression. We are following their footprints in a small way we can. So that is why panther's paw.
Yogesh, you have been engaging with the Dalit Panther literature, particularly in Marathi language. And now, nowadays, you are working with writers, young writers from all over the country, and speaking several regional languages. Right? Was the Dalit literary movement in Maharashtra had a production of Dalit literature, like, for example, say Dalit literature in Telugu or Tamil or in Hindi? Or was the Dalit Panthers world, literally world, just remained within Maharashtra, or it went out as well?
It has a wide range of, like, wide, very vast influence. Now, we know that there are some of the remarkable works and the remarkable Dalit writers are writing from across India. Now, like if you go down to the south, like earlier Andhra, now Andhra and Telangana, so it had a remarkable body and a remarkable range of Dalit poets. I mean, superb, like the kind of poetry they have written is something really, really inspiring. Like also, but they also had a communist communist
flavor
lines on which they were working. Yeah, communist flavor to them, because they were influenced by the communist movement. And but excluding few individuals, yet they were Dalits. And actually, what I'm talking about when it comes to Dalit literature, it's about the life we live. You know, like you may choose a communist way of leading a revolution or writing a literature, but yet the life you live is your own. Your life is not you know, your life is not, I think that like you don't write because you want to write according to communist or Ambedkar perspective. You write because you write and the kind of life you live. You live, and also both are important, because otherwise and unless, how will we know where are you going? If we have only one thing, how do we know that other thing is what? So now going to Kannada also has a lot of Dalit writers, remarkable writers. Like recently I went to Bangalore and then I met some of the people there, so I got a few books. So we still don't know, because see, we don't know, we don't have a translation, right? We don't have translation, we don't engage with the translation. So there we have, in Kerala, we have few, let us say like S. Joseph. S. Joseph is a Dalit Christian poet. He's not a Buddhist. He's a Dalit Christian poet. And he's a remarkable poet, like beautiful poems he write. I mean, beautiful, powerful, at the same time, so, you know, like readable. So this we have poets and writers in Tamil, like N.A.D. Rajkumar. N.D. Rajkumar, like Bama, we know Bama. Bama is famous, but N.D. Rajkumar is a very much underrated. N.D. Rajkumar is a remarkable poet. He's like a musician, like, you know, he teaches music to children in school. He comes from, like, you know, his poetry is too much like talks it talks about the you know, it's like a occult imagination, but it also tells us that what kind of life our people live in Tamil Nadu. So that is how, because that is how we live, because otherwise we connect with each other. Otherwise, we think that what kind of life we live, the society, our Dalit community live here, it is the representative of the Dalit life across India. No, it is not like that. Then you go to up. You go to the Gujarat. So I visit Gujarat every like 2 months or 3 months. So I'm engaged with a few writers there. So they also had a Dalit Panther movement, very strong Dalit Panther movement, but it was declined. It was declined, and it has appropriated by the Congress by awarding some Dalit Panthers writers, the readers, you know, appreciating them, giving them appreciation, cash and kind. So, but that literary movement was still there. We also don't know that, like, because of the lack of translation, very few people know that there was a remarkable poet called Nirav Patel. I think he's one of the first Dalit poet who have written in English, and very remarkable poetry. I mean, very powerful poetry. He died 2 years back, but I mean, because of, we don't know much, so we don't, we are not emphasizing on translation. We go to the Punjab. We have Lal Singh Dil. We have Amar Singh Chamkila. We have Gurdas Ram Alam. We have so many people. We have Kamal Dev Park. We have so many people who are writing, who have written, who are writing. So we don't know these people. So it is because, but we can know these people. We can always reconnect it if we emphasize on the question of language and then translation. Then we can see the immediate effect of literature when it comes to, you know, making Baba Saheb more, you know, global.
Yogesh, you talked about the oral histories and documented by the several people in the movement. And when we look at the biographies of the great men, and as Baba Saheb says that the history is nothing but the biography of the great people, and we have had a lot of great people after Baba Saheb Ambedkar who has written on issues and also produce oral histories. So my question to you is, you know, when we look at the Sti, written by Vasant Moon, and it was translated in English as Growing Up and Untouchable, and, you know, it's like a sort of it's more than a biography. I think it's more of more a work of a history of what was happening in the slums of Nagpur, and, you know, what was happening in the akhadas, what was happening when Baba Sahib Ambedkar was giving clarion calls to do this or, you know, engage the community to do that. So when we look at the literary genre, like, you know, this biography come historical, you know, mix where you get the history documented and you really enter into that universe of Nagpur slums where you can see how people, how the community is responding to the movement. Can you talk about this sort of biographies as a documentation of our histories? Like Vasti is one example, but do you remember other examples of such kind of biographies which really are not about people but about the movements in that locality, in that context?
Dalit literature is very much rich when it comes to autobiographies. Now, when you aspire to write something, like, you know, one of the easiest form is poetry. But when you aspire to write something, like, you know, write something which you impact, and you write with a vision, then one of first generation of Dalit writers, they resorted to autobiographies. Why autobiographies? It was a deliberate decision. Now, when it comes to the literature, Marathi literature, or any other literature from that particular state, when it comes to Dalit people or Dalit community, ex-untouchable communities, now their lives, their stories, their song, their pain, their suffering, their joys, their ideas, their emotions, it is not seen or present in a literary form. Now, autobiography is a literary form, was very much powerful, envisioned by the Dalit writer, because it was equally an account of a history which was totally erased. Now, people do not know let alone the history, because or the life or the story, because it takes time to process it. But when these biographies came, even Marathi readers did not understand much of the vocabularies, the words. So which means that there was a total absence of any social contract between untouchables and the literary pundits, the Brahmins. Now, these Brahmins, their first criticism was that Dalit literature has the language of it is not literary, it's a rough language, it's a vulgar language. Now, it was a very regressive criticism. It was not a criticism at all, it was a reaction. It came from hatred. Now, literature is something, what you write becomes your literature. The way you write it becomes your literature, because each mind is unique, as Buddha says. So the way you write is going to be unique and it should be like that. So that is literature. The way my emotions are formed, the way my feelings are defined, I might take some other form to express that. So it may not be like a Brahmin. Now, this biography as a historical account is important for for a reason, that it has resurrected the history of emotions and feelings of ex-untouchable community. Now, this history of emotions and feeling was completely wiped out. We know that history of untouchable people, like as a social history, their culture was wiped out, but their history of how they feel, how they imagine, how they conceptualize things is, or what is their hunger? How do they look at hunger? How do they look at the interaction between man and woman, sexuality, love? It was not there. It was intimate history. So I call autobiography is an intimate history. Now, Baluta. Baluta is a remarkable, I have written an article on Baluta, on Fanonian dimensions, like what Fanon says in black skin, white skin, black mask, black skin, white mask. So it's a psychoanalytical approach, but if you understand the psychoanalytical approach and divide it into Baluta becomes much bigger than it becomes a kind of a world level narrative. So Baluta we have P.E. Sonkamle's Atvaniche Pakshi, you know, the birds of memories. One of the first autobiographies, one of the most remarkable autobiographies he had written from Aurangabad. So that we have your Sharad Kumar Nimbale's Akkarmashi, we have Upra, we have Ushlya, we have so many autobiographies. We have Muslim Mahar, we have Christian Mahar. We have this range of autobiographies. Now, these are the men. We have women's autobiographies also. Aidan, Maja Jivna, Aidan by Urmila Pawar, Maja Jivna Ji Chitarkata by Shantabai Kamde. So many autobiographies we have that equally written by men and women from our community, and they are rich with the history of emotions of a man and woman from our community, their ideas, also how they lived. I mean, events is a social history. So also I need to distinguish Moon Sahib's Basti, because I'm from this Nagpur, so I personally feel very close to that, because when I see all these places, Itabadi, Ram Tekri, Hanuman Tekri, Gaddi Gudam, Imamwada, I mean, this place pops in my mind.
You enter into the different universe altogether.
Yeah, into Gaddi Gudam, this Untakhana. I mean, you see these people, you grow up seeing these places, and you don't know the history of it, but he tells me that how many people, Mahars, one of the most original dimensions about the discourse of right, R-I-O-T, right, when it comes to right, people say Muslim, Hindu and Muslim. It was bullshit. Vasant Moon Sahib writes like a right in Nagpur used to take place between Mahars and Hindus, which means that Mahars, as Baba Sahib said, they were Hindus. Our idea of life was anti-Hindu. So we used to fight for our ideas and they used to fight for theirs. So there was a right. So, you know, that remarkable, who could have otherwise told you? Who could have otherwise told you that all other people, like in this Kunbi Marathas, even the Brahmins were nowhere in the Akadas in Nagpur. We know that. The only militant community were either like Kunbis or Kunbis or Marathas or Mahars. And Mahars were prominent in Akada. And also, who could have otherwise told us that there were Muslim Shahirs singing Baba Sahib songs during 1945s? There is no other way. That this is the history. This is the positive account. Now, all we hear is negative things, victimization, this and that. Now, who could have told that sweetness, like Moon Sahib's account was also very sweet when it comes to emotions of women from our community, of men from our community, how they were like, you know, total fakir people. They had nothing except, you know, that will to resist and make their children study. Mm-hmm. That's the only capital they had. Mm-hmm. But they used to die for each other, help each other. Mm-hmm. You know, they used to starve, but they used to starve together. So they used to share even the half bread. And that's because why these things are important, even though they are written in biographies or stories or poems, because they inspire us in odds. They inspire us in the negativities. They inspire us when life is against us. They inspire us to face it. And what else we need? Because we are human beings. We are equally capable of anybody to deal with any situation. The only thing sometimes we need is a little bit inspiration, little bit connection with the issue. So this is the legacy of the autobiographies we have in the moment.
Yogesh, we see it from the way people are writing, you know, on the Facebook or the short stories, and there are like thousands of writers who are coming up, not only in English, but in Hindi, in Kannada, in Tamil, in Telugu, in Marathi, because we see this huge proliferation of the writers across the community. And you work with the young writers from different parts of our country. You know, can you tell us about how important it is for these young writers writing in different languages and, you know, writing in their different styles, even writing in different literary forms, but with the same literary philosophy to communicate their experiences and communicate the kind of, you know, emancipation that Babasaheb brought into, or, you know, their own struggles to become to for the dignity and, you know, for the emancipation of their communities. So how important you think that these young writers, which are emerging everywhere throughout the country, to find a ways to come together, connect with each other and share their, you know, writings. You think what kind of importance you see in the literary movement today?
It is whatever the resource we get, whatever the platform we get to, you know, express our emotions or feeling or the idea of life, you know, maybe it's a Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, whatever it is for us. Like I'm looking at all these things or the social media from our position, from my position, and it is equally important. It is very much important for us to express and keep on expressing. Now, but we need to understand that these are the virtual place. It is important to express here also, but it is equally important and equally necessary for us to assemble, to meet, to gather, and to write collectively behind the virtual world also. Because, if I take it psychoanalytically, we were the people who were always untouched by the people. Now, that touch was not virtual. It can never be virtual. It was human. So if we remain aloof from the human touch, it won't make the movement strong. So to make the movement strong, like what Buddha says, the Sangati. So what Buddha says, like in Marathi,
coming together.
Say in Marathi, coming together. Vedo vedi sobat yet chala. On time to time, come together. So right. We need to understand that even though 2 or 3 people, 4 or 5 people, 10 people, maybe once in 2 months, once in 3 months, we must gather. We must write something. We must share together. We must publish it. So let us see how it happens. And when something comes together and it happens, when you do something collectively, it becomes strong. It becomes a message. Now, one of the first step towards it, as Mangeshwar and like we have talked about. So we have imagined this workshop called Ambedkar as Culture, so which we have imagined a few months back. So and which was supposed to happen in May, but because pandemic we had delayed, postponed it. Probably happened. So the idea of it is asking people who are writing about Ambedkar with Babasaheb's perspective, who are writing on him, who are understanding their problems through his perspective. Are such 10 people, like men and women equally, are like coming together. They are going to stay together for a week, write, and that writing will be converted into a book after a while or in a short time. So that is one of the experiments like we are going to do. So but we need to keep on doing such experiments. So maybe today we are just only 10 people, 7-8 people are gathering. Tomorrow maybe there will be 20 or 50 people. We should come exponentially. We should meet the exponential growth as a collective. So maybe in future like we will have something big with many number of people when the situation will come to normal, so that we can discuss only about literature and Babasaheb, nothing else. Only literature. We can discuss literature and Babasaheb, nothing else. So let us see how focusing on small thing, how big an impact it creates. So that is just at the idea level that we are going to,
But you already have a kind of an informal network of, you know, the writers who are writing in different languages, and you travel a lot. So, you know, you have kind of, you have a sort of, brought together young writers, isn't it?
Yes. Yes. One of the.
Yeah, please go on. So your internet is little bit, problematic, but it's go on. You speak now. It's okay.
So, we had a first meeting, we just named it Ambedkar Literature Factory. So we had a first meeting in Pune in February. It's in December, I guess. Last December, we had a meeting there. So we discussed the possibilities of creating something. So it's just a first attempt towards what we are going to understand or form as a literary movement. It's a pan-Indian or maybe the world, because we are going to also like English. We are also working on the translation. So which means that we need to connect to our people, our writers from across India and also from the globe. Like there may be people outside India also who are writing. And I know a couple of them. So we need to get all of us together with the difference of opinions we have, with the difference of ideological or philosophical variations we have. But our history is one. And our idea of emancipation is one. So the two points are one. In between, we may have some variations. So we need to, that can be sorted out only by coming together.
Very true, very true. Yogesh, we are moving to perhaps this last question of today's discussion. And I think this question is very important. You began with your talk with stories, and human beings love stories, and they are story loving animals. You know, the small kids, they love stories. And, when we grow up, we love stories, and we read novels and we read short stories, and, we read epics and so on and so forth. Even today, after so many years, Jataka stories are so famous all over the world. And then the stories in the Arabian Nights and also Panchatantra and Aesop's Fable and so on and so forth. So your topic today was also connecting the world. And you talked about stories as a vehicle to connect. Because as you said that the realities in India, particularly about the caste system, because I know that 20-25 years in the cross-cultural sort of communication, it's not easy to communicate the caste and the suffering that comes with it. It's some of the people outside India finds it very difficult to really understand, such kind of the aggressive society, violent society exists, and people still suffer because of, how do you explain untouchability, unless you are in that context. Yeah. So I think what you talked about stories as a vehicle to communicate the suffering of the people here, and also connect the world, wherever there are communities, through the stories they can relate to the situation. So my question to you is that the stories have got a lot of importance to connect the people. You see that this literary movement that we are talking about is also a vehicle for advocacy and for that kind of a solidarity, the humanity that cares for each other, create a more better humanity. Do you see this literally movement as a humanizing force for the humanity at large?
Yes, of course. One of the characteristics of story reading is that you understand life through many perspectives, and there is a curious process takes place when you read a book. So you, no matter what caste person you are, you belong to which caste and whatever, but what you are reading, if it is told in a way, maybe creative way, which can impact or directly deals or directly touch the chords of the people, then that person is affected by those words. That is the power of stories. Now, when it comes to our stories, which are very much complex, which other people hardly understand because they do not have or do not belong to that experience of untouchability, So, because our most of our anger, most of our words, most of our sentences, most of our behavior, most of our body language is defined by the history of untouchability to which we belong. That is not easy for other people to understand. That is why often we are called, we are given a, you know, a very demeaning name. But it is just because it is also, it is their ignorance. It is their ignorance. So now when I say that storytelling, the importance of storytelling, we sometime, not sometime, but we always exclude our children. Who among us aspire, want to aspire, or have aspired to become children's writer for our community? Because the children going to be the citizen in next 10 years. If I was understood, if I was, sorry, if I have understood Baba Sahib as a children, as a child, when I was in school, when I started writing and reading, if I was given a storybook of a Baba Sahib, I would have been something else. So by now, I mean, of course, like we are doing what we are doing, but, you know, giving them Baba Sahib, giving them a story of Baba Sahib, Savitribai, Phule, Ramabai, so many people in a story manner. As a child, understand what impact it is going to create on their fresh mind.
Right.
They will be rational. They will be reasonable being. They will be compassionate being. They will be strong being from the beginning. So they will be much, very much stronger. True. They will be much, much stronger when they will become youth. And they cannot be easily appropriated by anybody else, no matter what you write. Because they have got Baba Sahib as a, in story. So, because it impacted. So, because actually, like, I have written a short, small, you know, couplets, which are going to publish, which are going to publish the, publish as a children's book. So, it's like a small, it's like a Ambedkar as a reader. So, there are 16 poems, small four-line poems, but for children, you know. Small thing, like when I was a, it's like when he used to sit in the library, he used to think about these people. He did not want to spend any time doing anything. It's like that. So, I mean, it's just an experience. I have never written anything for children. I myself have been very stupid to not on those lines. But we need to do whatever we can in our lifetime. Whatever we think can possibly do, we must do it. There is no limit for anything. So when it comes to, when that book will be published as a children's book, let us say what impact is created. But from my side, I've been contributing in that way. And maybe in future, like I would be like specifically like for 3 or 4 days, like I will gather few people who are interested to write for specifically for children. So, you know, like let us, I mean, that's my idea, but that will be done.
Fantastic, Yogesh. It has been wonderful, wonderful to listen to your talk. We have like gone into the discussion of literature, into the Dalit Panther movement and the literary movement throughout our countries. The writers were writing in different languages, the kind of different literary forms in which they are producing this literature. I think today we had a wonderful, wonderful interaction on this, particularly on this very important topic that I think has a power to reinvigorate and, you know, strengthen, take forward the movement for the liberation of the people. And with literary minds coming together, I think it's not difficult to, you know, connect the people, connect the communities, because the caste is, By its nature, it's divisive. But when people identify each other with their stories, with their common plight, and, you know, with their common aspiration, I think it creates a magical world of solidarity. So I think the work that you are doing is very, very important. And before we conclude, I would like to request you to offer a few concluding words today on this occasion, Yogesh?
See, I mostly believe on, like, I am not a good speaker, and like it, you know, I am very much uncomfortable when it comes to public speaking. But I am I'm very much interested in doing things, actually. So I would like to conclude by saying that in future, like let us try to find out a ways by which we can connect writers from our community, like from our basti, from our colony, from our college, from wherever we are, and let us try to make a web of it, a big web. Like somebody from Kerala can do, somebody from Kannada can do, somebody from Karnataka, somebody from Andhra, Punjab, MP, Delhi, wherever we are, Gujarat, Maharashtra, wherever we can connect, or we can, you know, gather as a, like, as a writer, and then we can make a web of it, so that once we come in a huge number, like thousands, let us say 1,000 writers from one community, and that is not impossible. I know that, like, ऐसा बोलते हैं कि दलित बस्ती में जिधर जाओ एक पत्थर मारो उधर से कवि निकल के आ जाएगा बाहर. वो that is very much true. It's not difficult. So, well, if you do that, I mean, if you do that, make a web of it, I think it is going to be a very loud. It is going to be loud. It will be. It is going to be very loud expression. It will be a loud expression in a literary domain. It will certainly change something. So that is my concluding word. So let us think towards it. Let us think towards coming together as a writer.
Very, very, very beautiful. I think that's a very good appeal to the lot of young authors who might be listening to us today. And I think we really need to aspire to create our own literary festivals, our own literary events, our own literary, you know, forms of expressions. I think I'm sure that, you know, we can develop our own forms of expressions and whatnot. There is a huge scope, and with the kind of people like you in the movement, I think that we can do a lot in this direction. Dear audience, today we had my dear brother Yogesh Maitreya, who is an author, a poet, a writer, and a very good organizer, and at the same time, he is a publisher. So thank you so much, Yogesh, for sharing your thoughts today, and we are looking forward towards more of such events, maybe one literary event online someday, so that we can bring at least to our viewers today a few of our writers, and we can talk, we can have a dialogue between them. Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. Jai Bhim.
Jai Bhim, for your time. Thank you.